Good afternoon. You're watching Nine News Now. I'm Amber Sherlock. We begin with breaking news, and a jury has found Mustafa Durrani guilty of preparing the terror attack which claimed the life of New South Wales police accountant Curtis Cheng. The 24-year-old acted as the lookout and arranged meetings between the shooter and supplier of the weapon used. Curtis Cheng was gunned down outside Parramatta Police Station back in 2015. Police have shot and killed a man who was suspected of murdering his former partner at a home in the New South Wales Lake Macquarie region. Tyson Cottrell has the details.
Police say they had no other choice but to open fire on 21-year-old Tafari Walton after he threatened them with a knife at a home near Newcastle this morning. Addressing the media for the first time this afternoon, Assistant Commissioner Max Mitchell defended the actions of officers involved in the shooting, which took place in the backyard of a home at Glendale at around 9 a.m.
No police officer wants to be involved in these type of incidents, but unfortunately our job is also about protecting the wider community. And I think the police have acted very professionally and courageous on this occasion.
Walton had been on the run from police and was wanted for questioning over the fatal stabbing of a 27-year-old woman also at Glendale yesterday morning.
She was such a beautiful girl, like, she was so kind, she was very quiet.
There were emotional scenes this morning when friends and family of Walton visited the scene of the shooting. The police have set up a crime scene and a critical incident investigation has also been launched.
The Prime Minister has all but confirmed that another senior Liberal MP will be quitting politics before the election, with an official announcement expected very soon. Let's go straight to political reporter Fiona Whelan. Good afternoon, Fee. What can you tell us?
Well, Amber, I think we can now firmly say that former Minister Craig Laundy is leaving. There has been a lot of talk that it's happening, and now the Prime Minister hasn't denied it, which means the mass exodus of former and current ministers continues. The Liberal Party is looking for a high-profile candidate to parachute into Mr Laundy's Sydney seat of Reid. Now, this electorate could be a problem for the government. It could potentially fall to Labor. Scott Morrison was out and about early today visiting a fruit market in Melbourne, and while he was there, he was asked about his interest in Reid.
We're in a position to make announcements about that matter, that we will. Same answer.
We understand the government wants to announce the new candidate at the same time as it announces Mr Laundy's resignation, and that it's having problems finding someone to fill his shoes. Last week, Nine News revealed Liberals had approached former New South Wales Deputy Police Commissioner Nick Caldas to run as a replacement, but he says that he won't run, so the search continues. But in another marginal New South Wales seat, the Liberal Party has already found a big name to run. Warren Mundine was announced as the candidate for Gilmore earlier this year, and he'll be facing some tough competition from his own side, with the Nationals also running a strong candidate. Katrina Hodgkinson, a former minister in the New South Wales Parliament, was announced as the Nationals candidate last month. Today, Barnaby Joyce visited Gilmore to vouch for her, and he was asked whether voters should vote for her or Mr Mundine.
I know this person better, and I've got to give reference to the person that I truly know, not the person that I have met.
Now, the problem for the government is that running a Liberal and a National candidate could split the non-Labor vote. But as Barnaby Joyce puts it, you can't just have one rose in a rose bowl.
Amber? All right, Fiona, thank you. There has been a dramatic home invasion at Blacktown in Sydney's west. Emergency services arrived to find a resident with a gunshot wound to the thigh and another with an axe wound to the head. A 33-year-old man was seen running from the property, officers shooting him in the wrist, and he is currently in hospital under police guard. Another man was also arrested at the scene. A suspicious blaze has gutted a home near Geelong. The fire broke out in the garage of the property just after midnight and quickly spread to the house, sending thick smoke across the town. One resident escaped, while two elderly neighbours were also evacuated as a precaution. Fresh flowers have been laid at the grave of Karen Rostevsky just a day after her husband Boris changed his story and admitted to killing her. Neary Tai has more.
For close to 3 years, Boris Rostevsky staunchly maintained his innocence, lying to police and his family. But now, on the eve of his murder trial was due to start, the 54-year-old pleaded guilty to the manslaughter of his wife, Karen. And now we may never know exactly what happened to Karen and how she died. His shock admission comes close to 3 years since the mother vanished from the Avondale Heights home. Boris told police Karen had walked out to clear her head. 8 months later, her badly decomposed body was found between logs at Mount Macedon. Despite carrying his wife's coffin at her funeral, police always suspected Boris killed his wife, later charging him with murder. The brief of evidence consisted of CCTV footage, Karen's black Mercedes being driven towards bushland where her body was dumped, both their mobile phones pinged towers before they were switched off. Police suspect Karen was killed inside their home. The murder trial was supposed to start today, with a jury due to be impaneled, but that's all been thrown out after the shock admission.
Yesterday, the judge looked at that and said, no, I'm sorry, this evidence is not strong enough to prove the murderous intent. Otherwise, the evidence is fine. It was good to prove that he was the one that killed her.
Everyone's worked very hard on that case. I know the police involved did a lot of investigations work on it. They'll be sort of relieved in a way too that they're able to now move through with that plea.
The next step is a pre-sentence hearing on March 27 where victim impact statements will be read and Boris's defence team will outline mitigating factors for the judge to consider sentencing.
Convicted paedophile George Pell is likely counting down the days until his appeal after being sentenced to 6 years behind bars for child sexual abuse. The 77-year-old must serve at least 3 years and 8 months in prison for sexually assaulting two choir boys in the 90s. Pell maintains his innocence and will challenge his conviction in the Court of Appeal in June. The spotlight has now turned to the Royal Commission into Sexual Abuse with Attorney General Christian Porter reportedly in talks with Victoria Police to release secret findings from Pell's evidence. The wife of billionaire Clive Palmer has reluctantly fronted the federal court in Brisbane over the collapse of Queensland Nickel. Nine's Adam Hegarty was there.
Well, Anna Palmer's already been grilled for a couple of hours here in the federal court. It's to do with her time as the sole director of Clive Palmer, her husband's parent company, Mineralogy, between October last year and February this year. Liquidators for Queensland Nickel, which of course went under in 2016, are trying to decipher as much information they can about the company's assets and liabilities as they try to claw back the millions of dollars owed to creditors. So far, it's fair to say they are not happy with the answers they've been given. Mrs. Palmer's been quizzed on things such as the amount of transactions, the existence of transaction records, how much money has been invested in Australia and overseas, the simple structure of the company. So far, her responses have been she doesn't know, she doesn't remember, or she doesn't recall. Instead, she says a lot of the duties she delegated during her time as director to other staff members, other departments such as financial departments, but also to her mining magnate husband, Clive. Now, of course, this comes as around $500 million of Clive Palmer's assets have been frozen pending the outcome of this legal process in the Supreme Court.
At least six students and two teachers have been killed when two gunmen opened fire at a school in southeastern Brazil before turning the guns on themselves. The students were on a break when the men, who police believe are former students, arrived around 9:30 a.m. local time. At least 17 other people, mostly children, were also injured and taken to hospital. Donald Trump's former campaign manager, Paul Manafort, has been jailed for another 43 months over the Russia probe. He pleaded guilty to conspiracy against the United States and trying to tamper with witnesses. Boeing has backed the grounding of its troubled 737 MAX 8 planes in the United States. Nine's US correspondent Lexis Daish has more.
Well, US President Donald Trump has finally taken action over the Boeing 737 MAX 8 aircraft, which was involved in that devastating crash that killed 157 people at the hands of Ethiopian Airlines. He has announced that the country will be issuing an emergency order to have all Boeing 737 MAX 8s and the larger version, the MAX 9, all grounded. This comes after the country faced growing pressure to take action because so many other countries have already banned this plane from their airspace, Australia included. Now, he made that announcement earlier on today. Here is some of that press conference.
We're going to be issuing an emergency order of prohibition to ground all flights of the 737 MAX 8 and the 737 MAX 9 and planes associated with that line.
Now, obviously, the priority for Boeing at the moment is to try and establish exactly what caused this crash and whether it was indeed the computer systems inside this particular model of aircraft that led to the pilots losing control of the plane. But that is only the beginning of their strife, because now airlines who fly this aircraft are starting to seek compensation. And Boeing has come out today actually saying that they support this action by the United States, with a statement in part reading, "We are supporting this proactive step out of an abundance of caution. Safety is a core value at Boeing for as long as we have been building airplanes, and it always will be." This is, of course, only the very beginning of what will be a very lengthy investigation.
Social media has gone into meltdown, Facebook experiencing its worst outage in its history. Services including sending messages and liking posts are unusable for people right around the world. Emergency services have been forced to tell people not to dial 000 to report the outage. The cause of the interruption has not been yet made public.